So welcome, everybody, to the July 13th meeting of the tri-board. We have with us this evening representatives from the school committee, as well as the finance committee, and almost a full complement of the select board.
And Linda.
And Linda Sanderson, our treasurer, is here as well, as David Nixon. So this is the first time we've met in a little while here, first time in the fiscal year for sure. And what we have on the agenda tonight, we're to talk about long-range financial goals as well as our service delivery goals for the town. And we want to come up with a game plan to be prepared for the October 27th special town meeting. So with that said, we've tried to provide information that we think everybody is going to need in this process. So part of the posted board materials are a service delivery plan that our town administrator has put together. We'll kind of go through all this in a minute. The SWOT analysis for all of the town departments, including the school department. And if you recall, for people listening, that was a initiative that we went through last year, which was to identify the strengths, weaknesses, opportunities and threats facing the town as a whole, as well as the individual departments. Again, the intent being to utilize that for strategic planning purposes. We have a priority list for discussion. This is just one view of priorities, but we want to open that up to discussion with the full tri-board, as well as a calendar for the fall town meeting. And I believe that the school committee has some additional material. Is that right, Linda?
Yep, we have a five-year budget projection and a prioritized capital plan.
Okay. Okay, so just to get started, would it be worthwhile to do, I mean, do you want to kind of just give a high-level overview of what you have? I mean, I think there's so much material here, it's not likely that we're going to, in the space of an hour, go through all of this in explicit detail, but it's probably worth hitting the highlights, and then we can dig into that material in advance of our next meeting. Does that make sense? Okay. So do you want
us to start?
Sure.
Here's our prioritized capital plan.
Thank you.
And here's our five-year budget analysis. I think I would start with the budget analysis. I can go through it fairly quickly.
Sure.
We had a budget a five-year budget forecast of a spreadsheet about this big, and brought it down, summarized it into as simple a presentation as we could come up with. And so we've made several assumptions. So let me guide you through the assumptions, and then probably you can decide what we want to do from there. So we looked backwards to look forward. We looked at FY12 through FY17. We looked at the town contribution over from FY12 to FY17 and did an average annual increase for that five-year period, which is 3.76%. We also then looked at the school budget total expenses and did the same. Average annual increase came out to 3.3%. That's what you see in blue and mm-hmm. green. Down in purple then is when we started forecasting for 5 years. And let me just tell you what we did. We assumed, even though the town contribution was 3.76% on average over the 5 years, in the purple box we assumed that the town contribution matched the school's expense growth of 3.3%, and we did that because in FY17 the town's contribution rate was so much lower than the 3.76, we decided it made sense to be conservative. So we assumed town contribution rate was growing by 3.3%. That's the first row. We assumed our budget was growing by 3.3%. That's the second row. The next line is the difference between those. That is the funds that we need to make up to have a level services budget. We did the same analysis of grant revenue over the past 5 years. That average annual growth rate of grants was 2.25%, so we applied that. Mm-hmm. We then looked at the amount of school choice funds required, and our numbers started with our expected year-end balance. Once we finished closing the year, the ending balance that we provided to you when we did our budget presentation, we started with that and assumed an average school choice coming in number that is our average over the 5 years. So we added a $520,000 incoming school choice.
Okay.
So those are our numbers. And what you'll see is with the level services budget, and let me pause here and say level services does not include any IT upgrade. We have not, because the Select Board and Finance Committee asked us for the last 3 years to put together a level services budget, we have not increased or updated any of our IT systems in the last 3 years. So the level services budget doesn't include IT, doesn't include adequate facilities, maintenance, includes no expansion of curriculum or enhancement of curriculum. And you'll see that what happens is we project that we will have a $7,000, closer to $8,000 deficit in FY18, and that grows to $861,000 deficit by FY22, primarily because big numbers grow faster. So even though the town contribution is matching the growth of the budget, it's a smaller number, it's not growing as fast. The pink box assumes FY17 levels of town contribution, and all that happens is that the numbers become grimmer quicker. Mm-hmm. The only other thing I will say is that it probably doesn't make a lot of sense to assume $520,000 of school choice coming in if this is our reality, because we would be making such draconian cuts to the schools that we would lose kids, both incoming choice and our own kids. But at least it's numbers that have some logic and historical sense.
Can I just ask about the total expense line in the projection? Is that just a straight percentage, or is that, that's an actual projection that you've done?
That's starting with FY17, adding 3.3%.
Okay, so that's
that
all
number,
you're doing.
Adding 3.3%, using that number, adding 3.3%.
Because we took the average over the last 12 yep. through 17 to establish the 3.3 and find out looking at.
Okay.
It's a projection of the census of students?
This assumes that, again, this assumes that we have the same number of kids, basically the same number of kids, same number of teachers. Probably not the wisest assumption if we are having deficits going forward.
It seems like I watched your whole meeting on TV, and you really emphasized 218. You probably could wing it through, but 219 really becomes problematic. That's when everything hits and everything bottoms out, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but if we think that is our future, we would try to do something to stave off dramatic cuts in 19.
We would hope so too. I just needed an answer from where they were with bulk education. Were we able to get a reduction in the cost this year like they said they were going to? There was so much newspaper articles about.
I don't actually know how that ended. Our bittersweet news to report to you is our fabulous business manager, Chris, has left us. He's become the CFO at a local bank. So it's good for him, really bad for us. He left June 30th and was really swamped, so I didn't get a chance to ask him what happened with Smith Boak.
Okay.
I'll find out.
That's okay. I was just curious, Linda, that's all.
You probably don't have an answer to this, but watching it, there was really no discussion about a possible override and what the school would request. I know it's premature, But, you know, we've got to begin to think about that. And I guess Finance Committee's going to need a number. We're going to need a number if we go that route. And I'm sure we are. We have to, because we have to allow the citizens an opportunity to say yes or no. And I don't want to be caught not giving them a chance. At least we'll put it on the docket, possibly. I'm speaking for myself at this time. I don't know how other board members feel, but I think the opportunity is there. There's other things that would be included in it too, but it's an enviable time. The last time we went out for short borrowing was less than 3/4%. We probably could borrow for 3%, I think, Linda, somewhere in that vicinity.
Longer term.
Yeah, it would be a little higher.
Yeah, so we're
but it's indicative for us to do it now because it's an environment that is excellent for towns to borrow in, and we've got a lot of debt coming off. We could possibly do some things in terms and benefit the whole town in many areas.
Are you talking capital override for the schools, or are you talking about generating operating revenue?
Operating revenue. That would become part of their permanent budget.
Yeah, okay, so that's, we're not gonna
No, we're not gonna discuss that today, but it's too early,
no, okay.
But you know, but we've got to be thinking about a number eventually, you know.
Sure.
When we meet again the next time, we should have that number, I think.
We did the five-year budget projection to get a sense of the money that the schools would need. And to be honest, these numbers were looking so grim. We had asked Chris to come up with a third scenario of some modest enhancements to curriculum, modest enhancements to the schools, and we just told him to stop doing that when we saw these numbers.
Mm-hmm. I cringe but every time I think about layoffs because it affects a town so adversely, because once we lay someone off, we lose the position, and then we have to pay dollar for dollar what they're collecting at that time because we don't pay in. So it's twofold. You lose your employee and you're paying them anyways. So you've got to lay off more people to achieve a positive, in other words, you know, and that really hurts that much more.
That's been a priority for this school committee to not have to do layoffs.
I agree.
I think that's the priority of the whole wide town.
Yeah,
you don't
exactly.
ever want to
yep.
do that if you don't have to, because you never regain what you've lost half the time. My question to you is on the network components, your IT, with us doing a study on that, aren't we encumbering the school in that IT report?
That was going to be my question. Is
yeah,
there any way we can incorporate
we
it all together?
We were already doing a study on that.
I think the answer was no, the schools were not included. Isn't that right, David?
That's correct. Right.
Okay.
Yeah. So the IT study, the presentation that we had last time, was strictly looking at the non-school town. But I think maybe where you're going is, as we look at the necessity of raising additional funds, part of your capital plan, I would imagine. Wait.
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
Replace
That's
obsolete computers,
yeah.
right.
Yeah.
So, you know, that could certainly be handled on a bundled basis. And I think one of the things we wanted to at least talk about, and we'll get to that in a bit, is any opportunity for shared services. I'm hoping that are on the table. So again, we don't really have, we don't have any in-house IT support other than what you have in the school department. And at the presentation last week from the consultants, they said they didn't necessarily feel the necessity to have somebody in-house. However, we clearly needed to have standardization across the board, and I would think that having that across the entire system would make an awful lot of sense to then include the schools in that process.
Okay. Totally agree.
Okay. So maybe that's something that we need to talk to Northeast IT Consulting about, just to how would we go about coordinating with whatever work Mike Duffy and your folks have done in that regard.
Who are you working with?
Northeast IT right now.
Joel?
Gary Rivers.
Oh, Gary. Okay.
Your name was bandied about a couple of times.
We love them.
They said so.
The Regional Council of Governments uses them, and we love them.
Yeah.
Good to know.
Yeah.
That's what we went the right way.
Was the new generator at the elementary school a planned purchase, or did it just go and you had to get one?
No, no, it was planned.
Planned? Okay, did it replace something?
It was a town, it was.
I don't remember that.
Yeah.
Well, before your time.
Oh, before me, then it's just came the other day this week.
Took a while to get that project.
That's why I was wondering, I didn't understand.
Yeah. Hang on.
Does the estimate of your IT cost include the $40,000 that was raised by Helping Hearts? Smart Classroom?
Yeah, I mean, Helping Hearts does a lot. I know that they, it was over $40,000 in that last year. I know that goes a lot towards technology.
I don't remember if it does, do you remember?
I don't think it does, because what was designated for each building, there's a process for the staff, teachers and staff to be able to request. And it's not just technology, some funds were earmarked towards whether it be special services or the arts or music, but I don't think that would have been included in here.
No, and if I remember correctly, I think the genesis of Helping Hearts for Hadley Schools in large part was recognition that, you know, the town has a certain obligation clearly to take care of the schools, and much like the trustees of Hopkins Academy, the folks that founded that did it independently so that they could really look towards those value-added items for the school, not what should be part of the, I mean, it was never intended that those funds become part of the normal operations. So
gifts, there were gifts.
They're gifts, yeah, and that's why it goes to.
But it should be considered.
Yeah, but well, I do think that I'll go back and ask if these numbers assumed any part of that. I don't remember the answer. I'll find out.
Can I ask a question about on the capital items, so that the first two line item priorities have to do with information technology.
Yep.
The next one is the athletic fields, and then we have air conditioners, the girls' locker room, the second phase of the athletic fields. And then we have some infrastructure issues, drainage, resurfacing of the parking lot, ultimately a bus replacement that's it's probably part of our normal cycle, right?
Mm-hmm.
But, yeah. So this, and then the external grease traps. So the next biggest project is the phase one and phase two of the athletic fields. Do you have any sort of update on? I think the last conversation we had here, Berkshire Design was going to take a relook at the figures that they had provided last time, and then you were also engaged with CPA.
Yep, Berkshire Design Group. Thanks to Berkshire Design Group for their third revision of the field plans for free. Very nice of them. The proposal will go to the next CPA meeting, September 17th, 18th?
September 12th, if I remember
12th.
Correctly.
What Berkshire Design Group did for us was redo the phase one again, and it prioritizes using the land in the back that is not being used now for fields, and adding a new varsity softball field, a new varsity baseball field with an all-purpose, i.e. soccer field in between. Mm-hmm. So increasing the capacity of the overall field availability, and also adding a walking trail from Middle Street around the new fields to get to Hopkins, because another priority we had was safe walking access to the schools, which we have not had. And that project becomes a little bit more important to us if indeed the library placement happens in the area where the Hopkins gym used to be, because that then would take one of the softball fields. Right. It's a not very often used softball field, but a softball field that, you know, is right below the mm-hmm. old school. That would be gone, so the rebuilding of the new softball field would be great. And then phase two, if phase two ever happened, it would be reorienting the existing softball field and existing baseball field so that there are less softballs and baseballs crashing into wooden shields and sunroofs.
Sunroofs.
Does everyone know that We bought my son a car. He had it for 3 days, and a baseball went through the sunroof.
Was it open?
No. Well, it was afterwards, yes. So that is the field project, and we've tried to break it into two phases to see if that it would work, mostly because we wanted as much of that walking track built as possible, so we really could resolve at the same time pedestrian safety, trying to get to Hopkins and then potentially getting pedestrian safety too if the library ever goes forward in that location. Mm-hmm. So that will go to CPA in September. If CPA agrees, it would go to town meeting in October.
And that looks like that's the only capital item that you have that would be eligible for any sort of CPA funding, is that correct?
As far as we can see, yes. Yeah. Our current understanding of CPA, yes.
Okay. So just to kind of, I guess, sum up what I think you're telling us is that, again, to Donald's point, could probably squeak through FY18, but as we get into, you know, 2 years out and beyond, that in the absence of an increase of town contribution, which would either come in the form of getting a bigger slice of the existing pie or in the form of some sort of override, or a reduction in expense or some combination thereof. That's kind of it, right? Those are the only options in front of you. And that has to be put in the context of everything else that we're dealing with.
Well, let me rephrase. I don't think, you know, the other things that we could look at is, these are the options if we stay as we are. We could look at regionalization. We mm-hmm. could look at partnering with some of the area charter schools. We could look at tuition-based education, meaning that we don't have any schools and we pay other school districts to take our kids. You know, all of those mm-hmm. would require a lot of conversation and a lot of planning and a lot of talk.
Not before FY19, correct?
And it would be hard to do that before FY19.
Yeah. And we've been mentioning it right along, so.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Is still all of the school choice money in, like, your, I don't know, what fund did you call it?
Oh, I hope we change the name every year. Let's just call it the school choice fund.
School choice fund. I know we call it some, like, the revolving account yourselves, you know, which is fine. Is there anything on using that, any of that revolving account for any of these things that need to get done? Like, I know at one time years ago we were talking about using school choice funds to do those girls' locker rooms have been on the agenda for over 15 years or more.
Well, we wouldn't want to do that now because that would put us more deeply into the hole going forward.
Just funding the operating
schedule. We are using all of it and running out without doing any capital projects at all.
Do you know what's left in there right now, Linda? Or are we
Look down at, so we're assuming that we have a starting balance of our starting balance. I didn't bring the starting balance, the June 30th starting balance. It's 600 and something thousand. And we assume that we are going to bring in an additional 520,000 every year. And so that is using, you'll see this is assuming the use of everything that's coming in plus more.
Yeah, so it would be the 667 plus the deficit.
Yeah.
Right. Yep. So yeah, so you're starting just under 700, which is what we got one thought.
Yep.
Okay. So anything else that you think the finance committee and everybody else here should know, or is this, thank you. It's pretty clear.
Yeah. Well, picture. We're here to work with you.
And we are too.
Yeah. Mark, Amy, Valerie, you set for now, or can we move on?
I'll get answers to all of your questions.
Okay.
What we also have in front of us too is, I know David's done a tremendous amount of work on a service delivery plan, or again, the makings of one. Do you want to just kind of explain to people what we have and what they're looking
at? Sure. Just talk about it briefly. Happy to answer any questions.
few years back, we did a financial management review of the town of Hadley by the Department of Revenue, and one of the first recommendations made by Department of Revenue is that the Select Board should put together a strategic plan for the next 5 years. Select Board responded by putting together the Municipal Building Committee to address the immediate issue of aging in structures. And also, last year, asked the departments to put together the strengths, weaknesses, opportunities, and threat analysis, the SWOT analysis, which we used in order to prepare for the annual town meeting back in May. In order to support that work and to help take the next step, I put together a one-year service delivery plan, taking a look at each of the components of the town government, starting with the moderator and ending up with the capital improvement plan committee. And each division within town government is looked at in terms of its mission statement, or if in case they didn't have a mission statement, a purpose statement, the legal mandate, why is this part of town necessary, what were the decisions made about it, and then an organizational structure, and then the primary functions, as well as any budget associated with the department, and the number of personnel attached to that department. And in general, I won't go through all of the departments. You can read this at your leisure. What's revealed is that you have a well thought out town in terms of the functions are all represented and they're legally based. I didn't have any trouble coming through the record and saying, oh, why do they even exist? Why are they even here? There is a logical progression of decisions made over time in order to present you with the form of government that you have currently and with the departments that are here. It also reveals, and I've talked about this as part of my SWOT analysis last year, is that you have a decentralized decision-making process. You have lots of different elected bodies making decisions about town government. And it's been one of the coordinating issues of the town that getting everybody into the same room, getting everybody to agree, and getting everybody to pull together has been a challenge. But that's the nature of small town government. This hopefully will provide you with a roadmap in order to link your future priorities to the services that are currently offered, and to address some of the legal underpinnings, operational underpinnings, organizational underpinnings, budgetary decisions, as well as staffing levels appropriate for each function. So as you make decisions about where do you want to see this town go in the next 5 years, I think that this provides a good roadmap to begin that discussion and helps focus discussion on areas where you think that you need to have changes, or what do you want to keep as part of the town. So you mentioned regionalization of school. There's a proposal to regionalize dispatch. There are proposals to regionalize some functions of DPW. All of this can be addressed in a more focused way using the service delivery plan. And as we discuss this, and as the Select Board put together the five-year priority for the town, then the service plan can be expanded in order to map out how do you get there from where you are right now. Mm-hmm. So it can be a document that would support that vision.
Mm-hmm. So again, a way to look at this, David, would it be fair to say that when we talked about the planning process, we said we really need to know where we are right now.
Mm-hmm.
So we know exactly what life is costing us in town right now, mm-hmm. vis-a-vis the fiscal year budget that we're living with,
right.
and the deficit that we need to continue to discuss going into fall town meeting. And then this is what we're doing and how we're doing it,
mm-hmm.
right? So, you know, I think I ideally, just leveraging off of what you're saying, is that we really need to start thinking about the service delivery plan in terms of, you know, again, this is FY 2017. Should we be thinking about changes, whether they're structural, you know, staffing, you know, enhanced services, reduced services, whatever. But looking at this relative to 2018, what might it look like 2019, 2020? Mm-hmm. Because that then really helps inform a truer projection, a mm-hmm. financial projection. Mm-hmm. I know a lot of people are looking for that five-year projection. One's been produced, and people are saying, well, that's not good. We need to have the bottom line balanced. But until we really agree on this, you can't produce the other. And then going back to Donald's point, I think then and there we look at each other in the mirror in the eye and say, are we looking at an override or not? And, you know, to what extent and when and all of that. Mm-hmm. So that's your idea behind this?
That's right. So that you could see the effects upon the organization from a number of different perspectives, whether that be legal, organizational, functional, staffing, financial. It should be all laid out for you.
Okay. And you've included not only the staffing, but also the number of full-time equivalents, so you can see not just the body, but, you know, how much time the individual is spending working, whether they're full-time, part-time, and also the related compensation.
Right.
Right. By key area. Okay.
Can I ask a question?
Of course. Mm-hmm.
The on page 6, you have town buildings. Is that the cost of electricity and oil, et cetera, to operate town buildings?
That's correct. So janitorial service, water, sewer, electricity, gas,
okay.
oil.
And where's health insurance for everyone?
Health insurance you'll find under the treasurer's budget. And that is going to be on
13.
Page 13. Mm-hmm.
So that 900 plus 1,000 is includes all employees. Actually, that whole section includes all employees, whether they're school department or non-school department employees, correct?
Correct, for the benefits part of it.
Yeah.
Has there ever been thought of separating that out and attributing that by department or program? So that because really we're not seeing the true expense. We're not seeing the true expense of every program or department if we aren't considering the whole person, which is their salary plus their benefits, right?
But you just have to take in effect what your FTEs are. You have a number here of what it costs.
So you think just divide that by 929?
I don't think so. One of the things that we had talked, remember that VISDA, VISGov?
Visual government
program that we spent mm-hmm. the money on. Remember at the last meeting we were asking David where that stood. The idea of that program would be to take the, I'm going to just call it the pie, the expense pie, mm-hmm. and break it out based on these functional areas. But there are certain line items, in particular that benefits one, that needs to be blown apart. For example, if you had 3 employees in one department and they're all within 3 years of retirement, mm-hmm. that retirement cost might be very different. And they all have a family medical plan. That retirement and medical cost to that relatively small department could be significantly higher than another department with twice as many employees that happen to be, you know, in an earlier tenure within the workforce and aren't availing themselves of certain plans. So I think we did want to take a look at it that way, and that's been part of the issue of there's some work to break that apart and attribute the fully loaded costs to the functional areas.
So that is one of the decisions that I made when presenting this, partly because of time constraints, mm-hmm. trying to get everything else done as well as do this. You know, how should I represent the cost? So
yeah.
The schools have an operational budget, but they also have other funds which I've not represented here. And then there's a town contribution towards the schools, which also could be considered
right.
to be part of the budget. Mm-hmm. So I can do that work. I just didn't do it for this first draft here.
And the state aid, some line items on the state aid also lend themselves to there's a library piece that should really be with the library, there's school pieces that should be with the schools.
But you would have that, Linda, wouldn't you?
We have that information.
Yeah.
It's,
that's it, all broken down.
It does. We receive it all in one report, you know, month by month by month. So if we were to look at the total library, I know from my end, it would be going through each of those reports and adding it up. But there must be something, I'm not sure how it's entered in VEDAR, so I think that's something to talk to the accountant about, whether if they're going in, whether he can pull out those totals.
So just in the same ways, just in the same way as we do with the administrative charges for the enterprise funds, we can represent each of the departments in that same way. So how much does the moderator cost us in terms of electricity and health insurance? And well, it doesn't cost us anything in the health insurance, but in property insurance, and how much of the water bill can be attributed to the moderator? There's a number. There's
it's
a way that VEDAR can do that work.
That's going to go
32 cents.
Yeah,
32 cents. Probably a penny.
Yeah, not enough to send a postage.
No. Don't we purchase health insurance as a town?
Yes.
As a group?
Yeah.
Yes.
So breaking it out in various departments, and you said age-related issues. I mean, you can't really discriminate that way either.
No. We're not. Well, we'd be discriminating if we said somebody couldn't have it because of their age. But what I'm saying is that there is a to simply take it and divide it, you know, here's the total employee benefits and divide it by the number of employees, isn't truly representative of the loaded
each
cost of a functional area.
Each application to each department will be different.
Right.
But you know where the workman's comp is.
But even if you did an average, it was just that I was struck by the comment that this is a true summary of the cost of each department, and really, it is if you assume that Linda's responsible for $1 million of health insurance, and that it's not really a true. Even if you did average, you would have a better sense of what the true cost of the department is.
She's responsible for getting the checks out.
Right.
So maybe a better way to put it is that I think David's included the direct costs of each functional area, but there's more work to be done on the indirect.
I'm not criticizing it.
Yeah, no,
at
being
all.
Clear.
Yeah.
Yeah. Just clear.
I understand.
Yeah.
And I guess I'm more concerned with OPEB, the $7 million liability unfunded. I would like to see that go into the operating budget somehow and vote it, and it's paid every year. And if we come in with some extra revenues, we could apply that if we decide to lower the liability. But we can't keep pushing it aside and not deal with it, because it's going to affect us sooner or later on our borrowing. It's no question. Other cities and towns, it's already affecting them. You know, so we've got to look at it.
But we are putting good chunks of it away. We can't do $7 million all
no,
the
way. No, we can't. It's
but
impossible.
We're chipping at it as best that we can, and that's a thing that we do it every year. So I mean, we are working at it more so than other towns are too. So I have to give us kudos for that. So we're at least doing something.
We're
ahead of most of the towns. Mm-hmm. Exactly.
Yeah. So the last time the town did anything remotely like this was back in 1988.
We did something in 1988?
Back
That's
in
awesome.
1988, they commissioned a report, something like this. And it's revealing that the same issues as that we're struggling with right now are spelled out in that 1988 report. Okay, so what is our ambulance going to look like? Do we want to continue paying another town for that service? How well positioned are the police and fire to address the public safety needs of the town? I'm quoting from the 1988 study.
28 years ago.
Not to say that we haven't made a lot of good contributions along the way, we have. Not to say that the issues that we're dealing with are old and stale, they're not. They're very much appropriate for the day that we're dealing with today. But I think that these are long-term issues that we're going to be struggling with for a while. I don't think we're going to have a lot of answers to address everything in the next 6 months.
But so to your point, though, I do think a logical, if we're going to go to, let me rephrase that, when we go to the full town with a presentation of kind of the state of the union and helping people understand where we are, I think it's going to be very important for people to see those kind of fully loaded costs to mm-hmm. be able to explain to them, like Donald's saying, it's not just here's the total salary line, we have OPEB, we have retirement, we have mm-hmm. these other things, and this is how they get allocated, of course.
And all that stuff was brushed aside over the years, and it's grown to the $7 or $8 million figure now. And I just don't see the $245,000 every year catching us up with the age of our employees. And I'm included in that, so I can talk about it. It won't be long, hopefully.
So, well, thanks for all the work that you
thanks.
Did on that. But I think that gives us a good starting point. So I think if everybody can, I mean, obviously it's a lot there, but to try to go through it between now and our next tri-board meeting. Probably have a lot of questions or whatever, and if you have any, send them down there. So another thing, so again, we did all the SWOT analyses. You know, department heads put an awful lot of work into that, and the select board's been talking about that. We've had a handful of presentations kind of focused on particular areas, the DPW, public safety, the fire department, police department, and then certainly the municipal buildings committee. But what we tried to do is just kind of pull together a list of key areas of focus that there were definitely underlying common threads across the SWOT analyses. One area being just kind of personnel and personnel, if we can just break that down into different thoughts. Bench strength and management development. We have some departments where, you know, the knowledge base is spread out pretty well. If one person's out, the other person can slide right in and get the job done. There are other areas where there's a concern that the brain trust, if you will, may be concentrated with certain individuals, and to the extent a particular individual in a particular department left tomorrow unexpectedly for whatever reason, it might be difficult to fill that gap. So, you know, again, when we look at the workforce in Hadley, I think we do need to, in a non-discriminatory way, Mark, look at the workforce in terms of, you know, where are people relative to the likelihood of retirement from a planning standpoint, so that, you know, I think we can all name on one hand pretty quickly some people who've been in town for a very long time who know an awful lot who may not be here 10 years from now because they choose to move on to the next phase of their life. Mark already did so, but you came back. And look at the bench strength. You know, what have we done as a management team to make sure that we've got the skill sets to fill in? So that was a common thread. A lot of people expressed concern about that, kind of like what's the plan? What's the game plan here? And also from a management development standpoint, are we positioning ourselves so the only alternative is to hire from the outside? Because we, from a management standpoint, haven't given people the opportunity internally to advance their skill sets through training, because people are running so fast that they don't have the time to go to training, and we haven't provided any funding dollars. So that doesn't really lend itself to a nice tidy yes or no decision. I think that requires a fair amount of thought on the part of the board and the department heads. Resource management, are we utilizing the resources we have adequately? Resources even in terms of individuals, you know, are we doing the best job matching skill sets to the task at hand? Because again, you know, David just referenced a report from 1988. Sounds like some of the issues were the same, but I'll bet my bottom dollar that Hadley looks a little bit different now than it did in 1988. So with the advent of technology, stormwater edicts, all of that stuff, I mean, skill sets need to change along with it. So, you know, are we doing the best job of resource management? We don't have a human resource function. I'd be curious to know if anybody in the room works outside the town or you're listening from home. Do you happen to work anywhere that doesn't have a human resource department? It's kind of unusual. Not in municipal government, from what I understand, but I think in other places it's more common than not to have some sort of human resource function. And again, I think we're asking people to spend an awful lot of time doing that, whether it's through the treasurer's office, or David has a revolving door in his office, so do we need to really think about finding a creative way to provide that service? Again, it doesn't have to be a person, but the service. Making sure people have the resources to do their jobs safely and efficiently. We heard an awful lot this year about technology, people having to spend way too much wasted time trying to figure out how to format a spreadsheet to send it to the person next to them. You know, again, some of these things are underway, but these were common threads in the SWOT analyses. A lot of people asking about, go ahead.
And the IT people, the same thing, you know, we're covering a lot of that. Computer availability for some of the programs that we have going on that we should have got involved with quite some time ago, you know. Mm-hmm. I know on the DPW side, you know, the water treatment plant, when it was built, went with the SCADA system, the computer system, which mm-hmm. took a lot of hours off the man-hour side, you know, so they could get onto something else. In 1988, when they got 90% to upgrade the wastewater plant, none of that technology was available then. So it was all old technology, everything manual. You know, and somewhere we need to start looking at something like that.
Mm-hmm. And then the last one within personnel compensation study. Again, you know, I think we need to separate fact from fiction. You know, how are we paying our folks? Are they adequately compensated in the context of current market conditions?
Where are we at with that?
I'm chugging away on that one. That'll be produced very shortly.
Okay. Then another area of focus that came up, revenue. You know, we talk about revenue a lot, but, you know, I think Tim Neihardt in particular and some others pointed out that, you know, we have some obstacles to new growth right now. You know, maybe we can be working with our planning board to take a look at some of our bylaws and the restrictions that are in place. Do we want to rethink some of those? You know, this whole Berkshire Gas thing right now, I mean, we're working very hard cooperatively with our legislative team to try to get them to do something. And so hopefully, you know, we can show up in strength at the hearing when it gets scheduled. But again, that's prohibiting new growth. And for every dollar of new growth we don't get, we have to find it somewhere else. Use of CPA funds. We have 1.7.
Call it $2 million.
Almost $2 million in CPA funding. That's taxpayer dollars that we need to find a good use for. I don't think people intended to have it come out of their tax bill and go into a piggy bank for as long as it has. So again, we need to, sounds like the schools have a good start in how to spend some of it. Grant access, we know there aren't as many grants out there as there have been, but a lot of our department heads, again, are saying, you know, we know that we could try to apply for grants, but we don't have the time and we don't have any grant writing skills on staff. And then shared services with area towns. You know, is it possible that we actually may have some individuals who have some capacity to provide services to other area towns and enhance revenue coming in?
What do you do over the line that way with grants?
We're looking at shared HR right now.
With grants.
Which I think we've talked to you.
No, with grants.
In terms of grants,
yeah.
What do we do?
Do you guys write them for small towns?
We
some
do
of them?
Sometimes. We used to have a grant writing program, and we couldn't find a way to keep it financially sustainable. So now we do it as kind of like favors. So PPPC might also.
Yeah.
The capital plan, I mean, is critical. And so, you know, again, thanks to the schools prioritize their piece of it that will go into it. I know you're working very hard with the departments right now.
Just taking an eyeball look at the school contribution, it looks like we've updated that information in preparation for the annual town meeting. I didn't see anything that jumped off the page at me that we weren't aware of.
Right.
Okay.
We just tried to go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5,
yep.
And by year.
Yep.
So, you know, making some decisions on building sooner rather than later is clearly critical to coming up with any sort of a plan, because a lot of things are kind of at a stalemate. Got a little bit of a chicken and an egg thing going on here. Fair amount of conversation about infrastructure. Again, we have a new DPW director that's working very hard to get an assessment of the water and sewer and facilities. So I'm sure we're going to be having very soon some updates to the capital plan coming from Marlowe. And then equipment, you know, and other items for the capital plan that we need to pull together. So I think we're aiming for August to have, is that right, capital plan?
Capital plan is due August 5th.
August 5th, yeah. And then obviously work to be done after it's all pulled together.
I chase all the departments I haven't heard from.
Yeah. From a general government standpoint, again, common themes in the analyses, distributed decision-making, David talked about. There are a lot of times where people come in, you know, just from our standpoint, like, why aren't you, blah, 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 but the why aren't you isn't quite as easy as people might think because the select board doesn't always have the authority. David doesn't always have the authority. That's the way the government's currently set up, and unless that changes, we're going to continue to live in that, so we need to figure out a way to do the best we can. Volunteers, the lack of volunteers, trying to make this as positive an environment for people to want to come into is probably a good thing for all of us to be trying to do. We talked about internal controls. You know, the accountant comes in and immediately recognizes that there were some internal controls lacking. Certainly our auditors have pointed it out. So where do we centralize functions? Where do we decentralize? Should we be looking at centralized procurement, purchasing, so that, you know, we aren't all off buying at Staples, that kind of thing. The planning board's gone on record saying that, you know, at some point we really should be looking at a town planner. I think this is something the town actually looked at years ago, walked away from it for whatever reason, but again, the brain trust on the planning board is heading towards the end of their logical willingness to serve, so we need to be thinking about that. How do we handle information technology came up repeatedly. And also the idea of a finance director. Yeah, we have David, we have Linda, we have the accountant, we have Joan, but most other municipalities have some form of a concentrated finance director function who's the individual really responsible for putting together all of these budgets and things so that they're not doing it within a revolving door environment like we're asking David to do right now. And then there's all of the individual department issues.
Linda just stated that your accountant leaving kind of left you guys out in a cold.
Mm-hmm. Yep. So something to look at.
You have a replacement, though.
Because you
still
doing
have a
financial solution.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But they'll send you somebody. Mm-hmm. For how long?
I don't know. We got Judy Houle, who's a former superintendent, and I don't know if that's temporary or permanent. Just started July 1st.
So, then finally, then we have just the big decisions that we already know about in front of us for ambulance service. Do we go from a call force to a full-time fire force? I mean, some of those things I think we need to make decisions on sooner rather than later. We're all in agreement. The same with the public safety. So as we go into fall town meeting, people are going to want to know where are we heading with that. So, you know, with all of that, I guess the questions for us are how do we keep moving the ball forward here? You know, do we try to tackle these things collectively? You know, with the finance committee, does it make sense for you guys to go through, from your perspective, the information that David provided and your knowledge of the current budget and start coming up with some questions or your own sense of priorities compared to this list that I was just reading off of?
Mm-hmm. We get input during our budget reviews. We get input from every department. Mm-hmm. And we try and ascertain where the priorities are and collectively come up with a solution. I would like to remind everybody, though, that historically, both locally and across the state, Prop 2.5 overrides tend to fail. So don't put all your eggs in that basket.
That's also going to become the last discussion point. Because, again, I mean, I think what we need to agree on is what we feel the town needs.
And what we can afford.
And then what we can afford. And then if people, going back to the full town, say we really want this, then we have to figure out how to fund it. Right. I mean, I don't want to jump to the foregone conclusion that an override's going to fail. And I'm not advocating one way or the other, but I don't want to start out from the standpoint that that's an impossibility, therefore we shouldn't be talking about adding services, because to the extent we have safety concerns, you know, it's not okay either to just not do anything with the buildings or not do anything with fire. But maybe to your point, maybe we need to be looking at cutting services somewhere else.
Well, it actually comes down to the fact it's not us making a decision, it will be the voters saying where they want to put their money out of their pocket. Mm-hmm. And I think, you know, that needs to be brought to them so that they can have a choice. With all these things that we're talking about money, it's a lot of money. So it's not going to be something that they're going to be ready to put their hand in their pocket and give us. So I think it's something that, you know, really needs to be thought out. What exactly do we need? Where can we go? What's the most important things that we want to put out there to service the people here?
I think one of the other things, too, now, it seems like spring town meeting gets put together rather quickly in the end, and then we're there. We don't have a chance to have a forum educating the board voter why. I would like to see that happen before this fall town meeting. To get before the Gazette and the Springfield paper used to put articles in explaining all the votes and why. Today they're not doing anything, you know, and it helps that much more to have an informed voter and not everything be helter-skelter at town meeting, you know. So, and I think that was viewable the last town meeting, how a lot of the votes went.
Mm-hmm. Let's go with that agenda so that we can, it's almost 7 o'clock.
So if we look at the countdown to special town meeting, so David put that in the material, and what we're looking at right now, once it comes up, is so the warrant was open July 1st. The deadline for submitting warrant articles is August 26th. And that's when we're planning on closing the warrant. We'll be reviewing the warrant on September 2nd. So basically between now and August 26th is when anyone who has an article needs to get it in if they haven't already done so to David.
Yeah, so can I
sure.
just, we apparently posted the wrong countdown calendar. This is a year old. Let me give you the true dates.
Oh, yeah, this is 2015, doesn't it?
Yeah, it does.
Okay.
So I apologize for that for that posting error. In early June, you opened the warrant with the closure date of August 31st at 4 p.m., last day of August, and those warrant articles should come to me. And then we have a town meeting scheduled for October 27th, and on October 20th is the public forum that you talked about, Donald. And then a week before that is the last day to post the warrant. So we have time, but not a whole lot of time to put that warrant together. I have prepared and circulated a draft warrant already, which is the select board and the finance committee have a copy of that in order to start the process of thinking through the work that we need to be doing. And I'll produce a working draft warrant on August 31st when we have this, when the deadline passes.
So I guess what we'd like to get agreement on is between now and that special town meeting, there is certain information that we really, it behooves us to be bringing back to the voters. So how do we get from where we're at right now to there? You know, one of the things that, you know, we can work on is kind of lining up some of these issues and potential expenditures with a reasonable time frame. So again, think about the buildings. No one's suggesting all of the buildings are going to miraculously pop up with one big, you know, borrowing in FY 2018. As Donald pointed out, our treasurer has shown us what the debt service schedule looks like, and we do have some room, probably more room than people might realize a few years out from now, but that will fill up very quickly. So we need to make some decisions, again, on the prioritization of the buildings. We're going to be talking about the North Hadley substation tonight. And again, the Municipal Building Committee is waiting for us to go back to them with priorities so that they can keep working on theirs. But thinking about all of this and some of these decisions, I guess, you know, what I'm asking is, you know, I'm hoping that the tri-board can get together sooner rather than later, you know, not wait until the end of August, but perhaps meet towards the beginning of August. And, you know, in the Finance Committee in particular, if you would have an opportunity to go through this and have a conversation amongst yourselves, or if you, would you prefer to have some sort of subgroup of representatives from the other committees join you?
Well, we're still tidying up last year.
Right.
Something that we have to sign tonight.
The transfers, yeah.
So going forward, we haven't really got, until we've got the numbers tonight, we haven't been able to work with any, so, other than the gross projections. So, yeah, we'll probably begin together.
Because we just want to make sure, if there are things that you heard as priorities that we're not even talking about, we'd want to know that sooner rather than later.
You know, Madam Chair, I think I would like to request that we're going to be in a conflict with vacation dates all summer long now. Mm-hmm. And if the tri-board, the Finance Committee, can get available dates to David so we could formulate up a next meeting with best suits everyone.
Can
you know,
we
I will understand some people are going to be missing because of vacations, but if we could have the majority of people there, it would be very beneficial.
Sure. So, I mean, if we look at August, we're scheduled for the first week of August for a select board meeting.
Mm-hmm.
Does that?
That would be August 2nd.
Yeah, August
3rd.
3rd.
Yeah. So ideally, if we could.
That's right. People will be on vacation.
Yeah, you know, you know, we need to target. And, you know, and don't get me wrong, but I mean, if it turns out that the school committee can't be at that meeting, but there's a fair amount of work that perhaps the Finance Committee and the Select Board can do together, then I would just assume keep the ball rolling.
It would be beneficial.
Yeah. I don't see why not.
Okay.
Now that we're back in the swing of it again, mm-hmm. keep it going.
So what does August 3rd look like generally for folks?
August 3rd is kind of tough. I have a wedding that weekend.
Do I have a second date in August?
We are meeting on the 17th.
3-day recovery?
Whatever the pleasure of the board is.
Madam Chair, what about the 17th?
Okay, so let's make it the
2nd. We meet on the 17th.
The 2nd what?
Wednesday.
Yeah.
3 or the 10.
Oh, the 10th
Wednesday. The 10th is the next one.
Yeah, or the 10th.
Skip the first one and go to the 10th?
The 10th right now, we're not, I think we're scheduled.
Well, let's not meet on the 1st, on the 3rd, and meet on the 10th.
We could do that, or we can add it.
No. Negative.
She's saying shit.
It's summer. No.
I think the 10th will give us ample time to work on some new numbers with everyone.
So, should we?
You're meeting on the 20th of July. If you wait till the 10th, that's
3 weeks.
Yeah, 3 weeks.
Next week.
Mm-hmm. So, does anybody have a problem moving select board?
We're not meeting the 20th, we're meeting the 27th.
Right, we're meeting, yeah. Moving it from the 3rd to the 10th is what you're suggesting.
Right. Want to put that in the form of a motion?
I'll move the select board meeting from the 3rd to the 10th.
I'll second that motion.
Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Okay, select board's now meeting on the 10th.
Put a month on that.
August. Thank you.
Yeah.
Okay.
So do we just schedule a tri-board meeting for 6 o'clock on the 10th?
So I think the Finance Committee is still talking, but I think.
Is the 10th good for the Finance Committee?
I think they said yes.
Okay, I think so.
Okay.
Yes. Yes.
All right. We're going to try and get trying to coordinate a meeting before that.
Okay. All right.
Okay.
Okay, does anybody want to adjourn the tri-board?
I'm going to work with the Finance Committee on a couple of things. I guess we'll do that in the hallway or downstairs?
Downstairs.
Okay. All right. So if you can go continue without me, that would be great.
Okay. All right. So there's a motion to adjourn?
Correct.
Okay. Is there a second?
Yeah.
Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Thanks, everyone.
Thank you for coming.
Thanks.
Okay, so we are opening, we're continuing the select board meeting, the regular select board meeting at 7:07.
Thank you.
No, not on the board.
So the first item of business for the select board meeting? is the consent agenda. Are we ready to, where I have our meeting going here? Okay. All right, no sidebars. All right, so the consent agenda.
Motion to accept.
I have to read it off.
Oh, sorry.
The consent agenda.
Oh, we all read it.
She's moving along, right?
The consent agenda includes a variety of warrants. I will not read all of the accounts payable and payroll warrant numbers. The minutes from June 29th, the awarding of electrical services contract to Amp Electric, the appointment of Willie Danlico as the Municipal Building Committee designee to the North Hadley Village Hall Ad Hoc Committee, and a one-day liquor license granted to the Friends of the Hadley Council on Aging.
There was one thing on the Friends of the Hadley of Council on Aging on the one-day liquor license. I would like to grant the license, but I would also like to waive the fee.
Okay.
Yeah, second.
Second that? Okay, motion made and seconded on the floor. Any further discussion on that? All in favor of waiving the one-day fee?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay, that's unanimous.
Thank
all right,
you very
and
much.
Do I have a motion to accept the consent agenda? With
motion
that?
To accept the consent agenda with the revision.
Okay. Second that motion.
Second? All right. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Excellent. Thank you. Okay. We do allow for public comment at our select board meetings. And so I would ask now if anybody has a public comment that they would like to make.
I would like to read a letter for the fire department and police department. It'll be very short, it won't
sure.
take long.
Mm-hmm.
Please hand them out to the board. This letter is addressed to the police department and the fire department. My wife and I were sitting at TV watching what transpired in Dallas, and it affected us very deeply. And I said I had to do something to respond to the police and fire departments in our town. So I delivered them a letter Sunday, and this is how it went. It was very difficult. The breaking news in Dallas and throughout the country has been very disturbing to watch for myself and my wife, Catherine. We don't even know how to express our heartfelt sorrow to the Dallas officers and their families. One officer did 3 tours of duty in the Middle East, service of his country, only to come home to be killed on the streets of Dallas while protecting the citizens of that city. Believe me, Black Lives Matter, and every other race in this who lives on this planet. I wish there was some way to express our grief to all the families involved in the incidents that occurred. Right now, we are more concerned with the police officers and fire personnel protecting the inhabitants of Hadley. We know how difficult it must be for you to put on your uniforms and proceed to do your jobs with heavy hearts for your fellow officers. In this trying time, we can only be assured that public safety and the protection of Hadley citizens and their property are number one and will always remain that way. We will continue to express our full support for whatever it takes to complete your mission. In closing, we'd only hope that the Lord will take care of you and the well-being of our wonderful community we live in.
Okay, thank you, Donald.
Thank you.
Any other public comment? Okay, if not, then.
I want to make a comment. I asked before on that medical marijuana that the planning board took out a charitable organization.
Mm-hmm.
And also, I would ask for legal counsel, because there's a gray area. It's within the 500-foot setback of the mosque, and I want to be sure before I vote if it's legal or illegal, and that's the $50,000 question.
Okay, so the planning board is requesting counsel?
I talked to the planning board and brought that up, and I'm asking you, our next meeting, you're coming back looking for a vote, and I really cannot vote if I don't know what's legally binding and what isn't.
Okay, so we'll pass that along to the town administrator.
I've already spoken to him about it. I had the same question at that meeting, and it's very difficult because it all happened so quickly. The moss actually came in before the medical marijuana by about 2 weeks.
Right.
But they never put in their application that they may have child education or daycare.
Okay, but I think
so. That's where the problem lies.
Well, that's where the question lies. So the planning board has asked for legal counsel, so that will go through the town administrator. But again, it's public comment; it's not for discussion.
Yeah, I realize that. But
okay. So yes, we'll talk to David
about
that.
And what about that charitable organization?
We discussed that at the last meeting, and we asked for the select board voted to or requested that our police. Provide us with a suggestion. I don't believe that's come back in front of us at this point.
Well, I talked to the police chief about that, and mm-hmm. It's like total off guard and caught him off guard on that. And I certainly would like to see that benefit someone to do the drugs that belongs to this town.
Yeah, that's a repeat of your comment from the last meeting. We heard it.
Okay. I know, but
thanks.
I don't know if I'm...
Okay, so... almost at, we've got another minute. Anybody else have anything for public comment? Okay, if not, then we'll go into, I don't think one of our, have you seen Brandon? Okay.
I can check.
Okay, we're expecting an appointment with an Eagle Scout recipient, but we haven't seen him yet, but we did tell him 7:15. So the Council on Aging, would you like to go first with your?
My request?
Council on Aging Future Senior Center Plans, yes.
That would be, are you going to speak?
Sure.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So we would, we're here to give you an update, and David Story is on both the Senior Center Planning Committee and the COA Board. So he'll start us off, and we will be.
The chicken was very good.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Did
a nice job.
I'd like to make a few brief statements in support of the proposed change warrant article, which has to do with the future of the senior center. The 2014 population of Hadley citizens age 60 or over, which is about 1,798, is projected to grow to 2,023 by the year 2030. It is projected that this will represent 36% of the town population by 2030. The senior population of Hadley is not well served by the current senior center and the Hooker School. Access to programs in the building, particularly for seniors with limited mobility, is difficult because of its multi-story design. The antique elevator, which frequently malfunctions, is not very helpful in this regard. The main entrance by the rear parking lot is on the opposite end of the building from the reception area and the director's office. Visitors or first-time users encounter no help in finding their way, as there is no reception area by the entrance, and they must immediately navigate either up or downstairs, which are in a cold and unwelcoming hallway. The climate system functions poorly, delivering either too much or too little heat in the winter, and no cooling at all in the summer. The bathrooms were designed for young children and are awkward to use for seniors. In general, the layout and appearance of the center discourage the use of its programs and result in an underserved senior population in the town. The Municipal Building Committee has determined that it would not be cost-effective to bring the current building up to code. And even if it were brought up to code, its layout deficiencies would remain, limiting its usefulness for the growing and more active senior populations of the future. For safety, mobility, ease of use for those with disabilities, and staffing efficiency, a 10,000 to 13,000 square foot single-story building with energy-efficient heating and cooling is recommended for a town of Hadley's size. Such a building could hopefully be located on the 2.6-acre parcel known as the Hooker School lot, which is already owned by the town and has the ideal central location within the town.
Okay. Following that,
yep.
That's we wanted to follow up on last steps, which were looking for an owner's project manager that was voted on favorably by the citizens of Hadley in the May town meeting. The senior building committee has done an awful lot of work honing the vision, but we are not professionals in that regard insofar as coming up with the design, vetting the backfield, considerations that need to be done by professionals. So our COA board has elected to move forward by petition, putting a warrant article on for the October special town meeting. And we are seeking some counsel in the wording of that to make sure that it is saying appropriately what the board has voted forward and the Senior Center Building Committee agrees with. And we are also looking for some professional help, hopefully, by either the OPM that is scheduled to be coming on board for the town of Hadley, or another professional that the Select Board and the Municipal Building Committee deem appropriate for putting together a vision for the voters to be informed about when we get to that October meeting. So we're actually asking you for next steps and some help in moving that May vote forward that the town voted on.
Okay. So I just wanted to, when you said you're putting a warrant article forward, Suzanne, so you're talking about a warrant article for additional resources. So we have the OPM for the $50,000 that the town has approved, and we'll actually get to that. I'll give a quick update in a second where we're at with that. But you're actually putting a warrant article on for additional resources to help with visioning and design? Is that what you're
saying? We are asking for that, but the vote that was taken by the Council on Aging Board was to actually move forward putting a warrant article asking the town to vote to build a senior center on that back lot.
For the fall or for the spring?
As we stand right now, the council wants to try and get that public support for the October meeting.
Okay.
We are open to, we are asking for next steps. Mm-hmm. If it moves out differently in the end, you know, time frame
wise. If they get a letter and bring it to us, they don't need to put it on by petition if we vote to put it on a warrant.
Well, you can request to have David put the warrant article.
I know. That's
yeah. Do you want to speak to this, Glenn?
Well, one of the things that I would appeal for the board to do is put it on.
Yeah.
Without us going through the
petition process. Exactly.
Mm-hmm. And we're hoping that you'll support this. I would challenge anyone in this room to get into that Council on Aging Center at this particular time if they are in a wheelchair. Mm-hmm. And you're pretty much all able-bodied people. Mm-hmm. We have people that have difficulty, even though they got someone helping them get in there, to open those doors. So I think
we have a man that comes every Friday to lunch, and he's a very big man. His wife brings him down the ramp from the wheelchair, from the elevator down to the floor where the food is served. Mm-hmm. If there's no younger person or stronger person available, she's stuck there until someone can come and help her push him back up again. It's just not a good situation at all.
The elevator has actually been out of service for the last 3 days. So even if those people wanted to come in and had assistance waiting for them, they couldn't. And that's just one day in the life of. But I'm just going to make a comment regarding Mr. Clark, who is our COA charge chair. You know, I believe we need to have more conversation about if it can work to have the Select Board put that on, if they're going to back it and put it on for now. I think there's some fear that it might get changed or omitted at the last minute. We had a lot of senior voters that felt like the May meeting was a little ambiguous. Mm-hmm. They thought they were going to vote on warrant Article 11 that said, you know, with priority for a new senior center, and it never even got mentioned in the reading of the warrant article. Mm-hmm. It took people standing up and saying senior center. So I think there needs to be some discussion about moving forward in a way that people are going to be very clear on what they're voting for and what they're looking at. And that's where the petition versus the select board issue comes in. And if everyone would like to have more discussion as far as that goes and come up with something that's equitable to both, I'm amenable to that. But that is a major conscious issue.
Understood.
Thank you.
So how about if we, would you be agreeable? I mean, David had to step out for a moment to work with the Finance Committee on something, but would you be agreeable to submitting the, again, it's just the gist of your article right now, because there'll be time for refinement, but having that language to David, and then maybe at the next meeting we can just put it on the agenda after we've had a chance to talk with him about it. I mean, I can tell you, I for one am not in any way opposed to a warrant article for the senior center being on the fall town meeting in terms of the select board, quote unquote, casting a vote in favor of. As you know, I mean, there's an awful lot that goes into that leading up to town meeting that has to do with funding and everything else. But
correct.
So I don't think that we would be taking any sort of position this early on, but I wouldn't be opposed to the article being there.
Well, I don't either. And like I've said in the past, I think that the townspeople have a right to choose mm-hmm. what they want to spend their money on. You know, and this is one thing that mm-hmm. they have the opportunity to do. You know, there's going to be other things on the fall town meeting that they're also going to have the opportunity to pick and choose and yay or nay. And, you know, I think everybody deserves the opportunity to have that on there.
But when your articles aren't worded properly, it makes it difficult for everybody to vote.
Right. But David can work on that, right, yes. David?
I'm going to work on it.
Okay.
And so just quickly, David, the Council on Aging is requesting they would like the select board to allow them to place a warrant article in favor of moving forward with a new Council on Aging building on a special town meeting warrant.
Mm-hmm.
Or they're willing to do it by petition, but they would only do it by petition if there were, for any reason, there was some sort of challenge or obstacle thrown up by the select board. So can we ask you to look into that, and then we can discuss that at our next meeting?
Do you want me to just talk a little bit about
sure.
it? Okay, so the warrant article is easy enough if you would provide me with the information that what is it that you want to accomplish, then I can do the wordsmithing, show it to you and see what you think about it. We can come up with an agreement as to the language. If it's a petition, then, you know, it's a standard process that it goes on the warrant with no changes in language at all, which often causes more trouble than it's worth, because warrant articles tend to be very technical. If it's a petitioned article, then we're not in a position to make any kind of editorial changes whatsoever. So it's best if we work and communicate with each other. I'd be happy to do that, and we can work on that if I'm around all day tomorrow and Friday.
And could we also further commit to them that whatever talking points that the select board is going to utilize at the meeting, that they've had a chance to review those talking points in advance of us standing up
sure.
at the
yeah,
you can never account for editorial comment by anybody at the microphone, but certainly the formal talking points that we work off of, at least you'd be able to see
for the meeting. You mean the special town meeting when
right.
it's read,
right?
Okay, so that is a point that you missed. This comment was that is a point in deciding whether to do it by petition or ask the select board to put it forward, because of the last meeting, town meeting in May, and how it was somewhat ambiguous for a lot of the seniors that thought they were there to vote in favor of the OPM with priority for a senior
right.
center when it wasn't
right.
voiced that way. And that's where this discrepancy is coming in, just to clarify for you.
Right. And so, again, these are very technical writings. The particular article we're talking about was a borrowing article, so it has to go through bond counsel. Bond counsel tells you what to say and what not to say. And so I think that's, you know, one of the restrictions that we're going to work under is that sometimes the motion will accomplish what you're trying to do, but it may not say what it is that you're trying to do.
Didn't we just talk about apparency for the population to know what they're trying to vote on?
Right.
And they accomplish what we want, but they don't understand it?
So another change that you may not be aware of, but what's on our schedule right now, we actually talked about it right before you came in, is on special town meeting is scheduled for October 27th. On October 20th, now granted the entire voting population of Hadley may not show up, but on October 20th we are scheduling a public forum specifically to review the warrant articles so that people will have an opportunity to ask questions and have some back and forth. I encourage you to be there, certainly, if you're the owner of an article.
Where will it be held?
To be determined.
Okay.
So.
Big room.
A big room with chairs.
Probably in the senior center.
Yeah.
Yeah,
come on over.
You mentioned that you wanted to discuss this at the next meeting.
That was only because David was out of the room.
Okay.
So.
Happy to work with you.
Okay. Yeah. Is everybody on the select board comfortable with that?
I think they have to understand we don't have any opposition to putting on an article at all, and we'll put on whatever you want. But we still have to retain our independence when it comes for recommending or not recommending. So does the finance committee.
Understood.
Because we have to look at the big picture.
Understood.
Not the small picture, how everything's going to go together as a puzzle. And coming forth with the fall town meeting, we're bringing a lot of baggage from the spring town meeting that we don't have the money to do things already. And one thing nobody said about is a price. What do you estimate for a price of this senior center?
That's why we're asking for some
technical help.
Yeah.
Donald, because
I just wanted the article.
Oh, just the article is fine.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. All right, so you
can you tell me if there's any grants out there right now? There has been grants in the past for senior centers.
What you are probably referring to is community development block grants, and we looked at that last December, January, and February, and we're told no. I will keep looking,
mm-hmm.
and the French group is continuing to look. We're always ear to the...
Maybe we can put in a call to Mary Jane, too.
Can I ask one more question, Madam Chair?
Go ahead.
Please. Is there any discussion of sharing a building with the library at the new site they're proposing, half being the senior center and half being the library?
There has not been any discussion about that.
There's no interest in doing that?
There's actually a reason for that. Just because I sit on the grant money for the library. The state requirements are quite specific, and the library building committee invited in the folks from the state building association and talked to them about that feasibility, and they made it crystal clear, and Dave Wiskiewicz is here, keep me honest on this, that we could certainly consider putting that type of a proposal in, but they would probably throw it right to the bottom because the Library Building Association is very focused on promoting libraries. They're not interested in pseudo-funding kind of through the back door.
I'm not saying to fund the building. It would be funded separately. Their half and the library's half.
Then that's what I'm saying.
But they wouldn't even allow that, David?
They wouldn't entertain that.
Yeah.
Okay.
They would, like Molly said, they'd put it at the bottom of the pile.
Okay, very good.
If they service 30 other libraries and we're 31, that's how it would end up.
Yeah. Okay, so the Council on Aging all set?
Everybody good?
Madam Chairman, may
yes,
I?
Mr. Clark.
Just to draw this to a close, if Mr. Nixon could set up some time tomorrow afternoon for us, I think Ms. Travisano and I would be most happy to meet with you.
I have tomorrow afternoon free, and I'll be happy to meet with you.
You should have it free.
Okay, we need
thank
to move
you.
On because we have a scheduled appointment.
Okay.
So,
thank you.
Not going to take any comment right now.
Thank you.
Thank you for everybody for coming. Okay, so we do have a scheduled appointment. So, for those of you who are regular viewers of our select board meetings, you may recall that we had three Girl Scout Gold Award recipients a couple of weeks back. And tonight, we're very happy to invite Mr. Brandon Bushy, who's a resident of the town of Hadley, along with his father and his younger brother, who's also a scout, I can tell by his attire here.
His mother and sister there, too.
Oh, actually, his son Donnelly, I'm sorry. I said, girls. She's like, the entire Bushy family is here tonight to join us in acknowledging wonderful achievement that Brandon has accomplished. And I won't read the whole proclamation, but just have everybody here understand that Brandon has achieved the rank of Eagle Scout in the Boy Scouts of America Troop 504, which is the North Amherst troop. And Brandon community service project had to do with something near and dear to Hadley Hearts, which had to do with the providing of some picnic tables in the reservoir area. And Brandon has been a scout for 12 years. Sets a wonderful example for youth, adult, and elder alike. And before we formally congratulate you, Brandon, would you like an opportunity to tell everybody a little bit about your project?
Sure. Do I stand up?
Sure. Yeah.
Okay.
Thanks, Richard.
All right. So last November, I concluded an Eagle Scout project in which I built picnic tables for the Hadley Town Reservoir. That was a kind of difficult process figuring out who was in charge of the reservoir at first. Eventually, I figured out that was under control of the Town Selectboard. So I was able to write up a proposal, which you guys passed, which was really helpful to me. And we went around local hardware stores, picked up the materials we needed. I got the whole troop together, built the tables, put them in. And judging by what's written on them right now, they get plenty of use. So I just want to thank you guys for allowing me to do that.
Okay. Well, thank you, Brandon. And on behalf of the Hadley Select Board, I'd like to award you with this proclamation. Okay. Fair job, well done.
My brother was an Eagle Scout, and it went with him through his whole life.
Yeah.
Congratulations.
He was a rival school instructor in the Air Force, and that went with him there, and he just proceeded on. So it just it's a wonderful award to get.
Yeah, it's something I'm hoping to live up to.
It is, I'm sure you will.
When did you go to Philmont?
I went to Philmont 3 years ago, and I'm going again in about 3 days.
You are?
Yeah, I was late here because...
There's Hadley boys out there right now.
There are?
Awesome. Yes, there are.
I just came back from a pack.
550 troopers out there right now with 12 people.
Oh, cool. Yeah, so...
So you might bump into them.
We might. Literally going in like 3 days, leaving this Saturday.
They're in the middle of their hike right now. They're doing 60 miles in 10 days.
Yeah, we might catch them right at the end then. Yeah.
Well, safe journey. Okay. And
good
of course,
luck,
it goes without saying, congratulations to the entire family for supporting Brandon and his efforts.
Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you. It's always nice to do the nice part.
Okay. So David, if it's okay with you, rather than going into the town administrator's report, we have some folks here to talk about the North Hadley.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, okay. Okay.
So Mr. Greenbaum is here with his are we talking about the clarification of the proposal?
Yes, we're going forward with that tonight. It's on the table long enough.
So Mr. Greenbaum has clarified his proposal. He's offered to purchase the entire parcel if we decide that we want to sell all the property for $100,000. The original bid was for $72,000 for a different configuration based upon the request of the town in order to reserve more of the land, more of the land for a possible North Hadley fire substation. He's offering to donate that additional land for a reduced price, $40,000. And so if we're thinking about value equivalence, that's allowable within the procurement. So that is the clarification of his proposal at this time. Did I leave anything out?
No, I think that's pretty clear. Thank you for allowing me to present my proposal today. very interested in renovating this building. It's a beautiful building. I know the use isn't top on the town's interest, but I can assure you 10 studio/one-bedrooms will not be lived in by undergraduate students. There's a strong need for young professionals, grad students looking for one-bedroom studios, you know, single-room occupancies. I have some preliminary plans I can pass around if anyone's interested in taking a look. I am interested in purchasing the whole parcel. I am cooperating with the group who's interested in building the fire substation there. They were kind enough to give me 50 feet of frontage to the north, which would allow me 10 parking spaces. It probably wouldn't satisfy the demand. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Thank you.
They could really use 20 spots to keep everything clean. But I want to cooperate with the town and this group, and, you know, I just made it clear that, you know, if their fire station goes somewhere else, I would have a strong desire to have the whole parcel.
I'm all in favor of this.
Yeah, I'll answer questions. I don't really know.
You have, on this here, he has 15. You have 15.
That was the original. That was before.
Okay, before. So what you say will just fit the 10, probably.
Correct, yeah.
Okay. They're very interested in doing the fire station there. That has not yet gone all the way.
I understand.
So I guess my question to you is, this is my thoughts.
Jeff, go ahead.
I'm willing to sell the building to you for $40,000 in the dimensions that have been offered, allowing them to proceed with doing the fire substation on that other piece of property. If for some reason that fire station does not go through all the hoops and angles of whatever town meeting does, would you still be interested in the other part of that property?
Yeah, I would desire the remainder of the land to preserve the open space. I think it should come along with the building. And I would also use it for the parking that the building would require. So yes.
So that would be my concern and my thoughts. I would, you know, I'm going to make a motion and then we'll have discussion. Can that be possible?
Okay, I've got a question.
Could we have more discussion before the motion, please?
Sure, go ahead.
You know, I have a real problem with this if the sub-fire station doesn't go through. And he's offering $100,000 then for the additional land. I think 50 feet is enough to accomplish what he has. He also has a parcel across the street if he needs additional parking, which could be utilized very easily, at least a half acre he has there, maybe 3/4 acre. But my problem is, if he retains that land, then we lose all availability for the town to access the lake. If that doesn't go through, we still retain the land, and we have the opportunities to create a park for future use on the lake. That's a scenic byway, Route 47. There's money available. We can attain that money. He wouldn't be able to get it unless he wanted to put his own money in to create a park. We would be able to utilize that land much better for the uses of the inhabitants of the town of Hadley. I wouldn't relinquish it.
And I'm not saying really relinquish it if the substation wasn't able to go through there. I'm saying he would still have the opportunity to bid on it. I'm not making a deal with him to sell the building plus the property. I was just saying that if we sold you the building at this point and things didn't go through with that, you would still be interested at some later date to look to have us sell it if that was the wish of the board at that time, correct?
Correct.
And Joel, can I just ask a question? And again, so I get these numbers confused. The original bid was for 70?
72. We had stripped off some land because in
That's right. That was like that site two or whatever.
They wanted a easement to the lake.
Right,
and
I was trying
really
to remember how
to manage that.
We went from 72 to the 100 now.
Right. For the whole thing, yes.
For the whole thing. Would there be any interest in going to back to the 72? Or at this point, are you only interested in...
The 72, you mean coming back to that easement to the lake?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's fine.
So you'd be willing to do that as well. So that goes to your point about, so there's still an opportunity to come back to the table with you to...
I'm very flexible.
Yeah, you are very flexible. But I agree with Donald, just from the standpoint that I think that there's been a fair amount of feedback, at least that I've heard of people who were concerned about the town completely losing access to the lakefront.
Yeah, well, I mean,
well, they wouldn't lose
I can
access
cooperate
to lose
on
the
that
boat
as well.
Ramp. I mean, they do have access to the water.
Flexibility around access to the lakefront.
Legally, where do we stand when we went out to bid for X amount of dollars?
The green ones.
And now we're moving the numbers around with this.
So you're in a situation where you put out an RFP for property. You offered four options for people to configure the lot. Mr. Greenbaum came back with an offer for most of the land at plus the building. In subsequent conversations, the town decided that they want to explore, at least for the moment, explore a larger part of the land being retained by the town and used for possibly a fire substation. So Mr. Greenbaum is offering a clarification of his bid based upon the town's request. The Mr. Greenbaum and I have had a conversation about the timing of the purchase and sale agreement. We're in agreement that we would wait till the fall town meeting to unfold, and that way we have a better sense of how much money are we willing to devote to a project, whether we have a viable project at all, and we would sign this purchase and sale agreement in November. So that is my understanding of where you are right now.
So legally, where are we with this? In
here.
The best interest of the town, if someone questions this, or what do you have from the lawyer about the situation? When we've already got the figures in writing when we open the envelopes.
Well, this is, that's the whole, this is different.
I know, that's what I'm trying to say.
I mean,
I understand that, but we went out on a bidding process for the request for proposals, and now they're all changed.
Can you recap your, I think you made an opening statement to that regard, didn't
right,
you?
So my understanding of the situation, and, you know, I haven't gone to town council and asked.
That's
about
what I'm
this.
Asking.
All right, well, I haven't done that. So my understanding is that you went out, you had a range of options for people to purchase. You received two bids, two different configurations. The configuration that you're most interested in was a sliver of land on the north side down to the lake, and then everything else would be sold for a particular price. Then you went and thought, okay, maybe that sliver of land needs to be a larger piece of land and change the use from access to the lake to a possible fire substation. So if you're going to change the scope of the project, then there has to be some sort of value adjustment. So that's the way I'm looking at it right now.
I mean, when we go out to bid for the roof and we change something, we got to go out and rebid it.
It's a little different.
It's a little different, but it's the same. The dollar figure is there, you know?
It's negotiable.
Yeah.
And it's negotiable.
I mean, it's negotiable up to a point. I mean, you can't change the scope of the work. But here we're just talking about a clarification of how much property did we want to retain out of the four options that you were offering.
It would be different if you added land to it, but to
initially, Mr. Greenbaum requested 40 feet for parking. We, the committee, I should say, grant him another 10 feet to 50. Which I think creates more than 20. I don't know where he's coming up with only 20. But in the process, this is a municipal facility and we want to be a good neighbor to everyone. We would allow shared parking at this facility, which has over 40 parking places. and it still has an additional 12 for firefighters that no one could park in when they respond to the call. So there's ample parking for everybody. This design is designed to get an undesirable area in front of the church where they park on both sides of the road, crossing the road, very dangerous there where somebody could get hit very easily. We're trying to get them off of there and share some parking with them to make it work as a community effort for everyone. And the design is excellent. I think he has enough with 50 feet, and he doesn't have to retain the rest of the land.
Tim, you wanted to say something?
Yeah, I need to say something as the zoning enforcement officer. There's a lot of statements that have been made about parking with regard to off-street parking that he could do, off-site parking with regard to setbacks. All the proposals that have been in front of you actually do not meet our zoning bylaws. And we have required everybody, we've been very specific to when people go through site plan, that they have to meet our zoning. So we need to be a little cautious about how we go forward with this. And I brought it up several times. These are sketches. This is the parking that's been proposed does not meet our zoning. And I really would not want us to get into a situation where we give a lot of variances with regard to parking just to get these things in. I think we need to really, and I've said this several times, we have to spend a little bit of money and make sure that the fire station meets requirements. Mm-hmm. Same with Joel. Joel is here. I think everybody wants this to go forward, but we're stuffing a lot of parking in a very, very small space for him that does not meet our zoning right now. So I would prefer that we think about that when we start thinking about how much we're going to, quote, give him for parking. Mm-hmm. Let's make sure that the zoning for parking is met, and then pull back if need be, if it does not fit and be compatible with what we think we're going to do possibly with a fire substation. We've been doing it backwards, in my opinion. Mm-hmm. We're saying, let's try to get as much as we can for the fire substation without making him, with him compromising quite a bit. And There's some serious issues here with parking, because technically, when you look at apartments, you want to try to give
two per.
Mm-hmm. So that means 20. We don't allow, under our zoning, mm-hmm. parking within the 50-foot front setback. We don't allow parking in the 15 set. Now, of course, on the side, but of course, everything up there is non-conforming, and we can give and take a little bit, but I just hate to see us giving a lot of this and then have to go back and say, well, sorry, you know, we're a municipality.
And set a precedent yes. where the municipality just, well, you just did it for that guy, why aren't you doing it for me?
Well,
and I see it coming down the road.
Can we just ask Mr. Greenbaum, your plans, were you filing for a ZBA hearing, and could you tell people where we are with that?
I submitted my application this morning for a variance with the ZBA, and that's just to change the use of the building.
Okay, so nothing to do with parking?
No.
Okay. And if I may reiterate on that, and we've had several discussions with everybody on my opinion on how these, how we should go forward with the ZBA. Mm-hmm. The first and most critical one is what Joel is going forward with. That will be the first hearing. That has to do with the number of apartments. If that goes through, then we go into the second phase of the hearings relative to the site, okay? And that's where we can get into splitting the parcel up into two non-conforming parcels, because we know that they're going to be non-conforming. But in order to do that, we have to be pretty specific to some extent on what we're doing. Mm-hmm. And with that, we can also do a finding relative to any parking or any other issues that are relative to the site plan, and it's on both sides. Yeah, and there's going to be some, but and that's how it should go forward. Those two together, but with his variance separate as the first hearing, and then go into the other two as a combination.
Madam Chair, can I answer that comment? You know, we've had a major problem with Echelon. They had a slight site plan review. They're parking all over the common. Why aren't we enforcing that?
Okay.
I think actually...
We're going to talk about it later, yeah. But yeah. That's so, the same scenario, and it's not being enforced.
It is not.
It's not
It is not the same scenario, but we'll talk about that later.
Tim, I think John, Mr. Michkowski from the ad hoc committee would like to add something.
Mr. Greenbaum goes in alone with this project, he'll fail. The only reason that's going to pass is because the town is going to make that lot, it's conforming now, non-conforming. And I know our board would vote no on that because they're not going to support. The only reason they do because the municipality is going to use that other parcel.
And that's good.
But I as one would not vote for apartments in this town. Because the town is creating this hardship, and it is a hardship, and you know it, the ZBA can do all this stuff to make this work. And they indicated that they would work with us.
Yes.
The planning board indicated they looked at that plan, they liked that plan.
But what I'm saying, John, is let's go forward with the site and with a lot of forethought on how it all can work out as close as possible to zoning. Mm-hmm. And what I don't want, I mean, we have some sketches here that don't meet a lot of zoning issues. It could very well be that after we go through some really good, thoughtful process, we're going to have a number of.
Let the ZBA figure that out, not you.
Well, and Tim, can I just ask, to your point, and I just want to understand from a process standpoint. We have a proposal to purchase in front of the select board tonight, and I know Joyce was just about to make a motion, so we're allowing for further discussion, but a motion's coming, well, I'm sure.
Sooner. Move it along.
And I just want to understand, to the extent that this proposal is accepted, is it it sounds like you're just making a point about the process from here forward.
Yes.
Okay,
yes.
You're not saying that this proposal needs to be changed. You just want to make sure your voice is heard.
No, right. I just want to be cautious about how we proceed with regard to splitting it up and parking issues.
Got it. But that to John's point, then mm-hmm. that is the next step.
Yes.
And that would be
okay. Exactly.
Yep.
Don's example of Echelon is a great example on whether this building doesn't have enough parking to do the same thing. I mean, I'm not expecting it to be, you know, it's not going to be overstuffed with people, but a large one bedroom could be lived in by a couple. Mm-hmm. There's guests, you know, and it's not clean. You know, it's going to be an eyesore to the town, and that's pretty much my biggest concern.
With regard to parking.
Parking,
right.
Parking's very important.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I was hoping to keep the south side of the building all green.
But there is parking there now.
Yeah, there's parking there.
You want to take it away.
Yeah, it makes the building look better. Mm. It's not a fire station anymore.
Okay, so do you still want us to consider your proposal?
Yes.
Okay.
All right, so I'm going to make a motion.
I just want to say, do you have an objection if we strike out that you get the remainder of the land if the subfacing fails?
That wasn't what I was proposing.
No, I'm just asking this question before you make your proposal, because I may make a friendly amendment to your proposal.
That you haven't heard yet.
No, I haven't heard yet, but I'm just seeing if he would object to it so we can save time in essence.
Yeah, I would object.
Okay.
Okay.
What
so
did he say he would object to?
So, Joyce, did you want to make
a... So I'm going to make a motion that we accept the sale of the land and the building as stated for the 50-foot side of the North Hadley Hall.
I'm sorry to interrupt you.
Go ahead.
Perhaps once the subcommittee can fine-tune the size of their building, maybe there might be room.
We did.
You did.
It's 100 by 65.
So...
Okay.
David?
Maybe the best way to proceed from here, and to correct me if I'm wrong. So I received from the subcommittee the variance, which application, which I signed. I passed it on to the building inspector. So I think that internal process can be used in order to clarify your concerns about the parking. We have a vote from the select board to accept the bid already. We're clarifying the bid. We're willing to talk with Mr. Greenbaum. We're willing to work with him, and he's willing to work with us on the purchase and sale agreement in November. I think if you're uncomfortable with any part of this, we can certainly take a little bit of time, as you suggested, to make sure that we have all of the issues worked out in order to move forward. Is that what
That's
I heard?
Correct, yeah.
Okay, all right.
Tim, is that filed with the town clerk?
So,
pass over this for the evening.
So I think that
we've already done a vote already, correct?
So you're okay. I mean, we're going to be signing the purchase and sale agreement in November. We're going to be trying to work with the subcommittee in order to come up with a fire station substation. We're working with the buyer to make sure that he's paying a fair price for the property that he's receiving. So I think things are coming together. Mr. Greenbaum did clarify his bid. He also put a date, an acceptance date on that. I've had a conversation with you, and you said that you're flexible about that date. So I think we have a room that's full of goodwill.
Mm-hmm.
We have a project which is moving forward on several fronts. I think we're in a good place with this particular project.
Okay, so then I'd ask that we hold on taking a formal vote.
We already took one.
Is
that problem?
You know, I think one thing that people won't understand, this building, we're trying to build it as big as it can be built so we don't have to ever go back there and rebuild onto it again. We want to get the most out of that lot. Once a constructor on our committee, Frank Acquadro, builds buildings all the time. And that was the first suggestion he made. If we can alternate the plan somehow to accommodate you, Joe, you know, by freeing up some more land, by situating the building differently, if we come up to that, we could discuss it, but I don't know if it can. I don't think so. Yeah, you know, and it seems like where we are with the 50 feet is the best scenario to accommodate getting the best value for our dollar for the substation.
That's exactly the point I'm trying to make. And I spoke to every one of you individually, and I said, is this a 20-year fix for the fire department, or is this a 60 or 80-year plan for a future of the... I'm speaking right now, Mr. Michkowski.
Okay.
I would appreciate you listen for a little bit.
I don't like what you're saying.
Good.
Go
you
ahead,
can tell me about it later, then.
I'll tell you right now.
So if we're not looking that far ahead down the road, I just can't see building a new police and fire station every 20 years.
Mm-hmm.
We've got one that's outdated right now on East Street.
Mm-hmm. So I just want to, again, going back to what David is suggesting in conversation with Joel Greenbaum. So tonight there's been further feedback, but clearly there's more work to be done specific to that substation. So that project is continuing to move forward, but there's no foregone conclusion on how it's going to end, right?
Yeah.
So David, what I think I'm hearing you say is let's keep the conversation going. We're acting in good faith. You know, we have a bona fide purchaser here. But let's let some further things play out a bit.
Mm-hmm.
Is that what you're saying?
Yeah.
And Joel's amenable to that? Right? Okay. So in light of that, then there's no action that the board needs to take at this time.
I think it's information, communication, making sure that we have clarity in the room.
Okay.
So you don't need to vote on the change of the amount?
I wouldn't take that vote right
now.
Right.
Let's just leave it alone. That's it.
Could
one more thing from the audience before we move on?
Yeah, I just have a general question for the planning board. Now, John is saying that the planning board would never vote for 10 single-unit apartments.
but they might vote for it if the substation goes through?
Standing alone because of what the town will create. The town is creating this. And by a private person rebuilding the North Hadley Hall, which it's out of the question for the town, that's why they would allow this, because they're getting the best of both worlds. They're getting a substation and they're getting a historic building rebuilt.
John, are you speaking for yourself or for the
planning? No, we talked about that at the planning.
But I just want to understand this. So it's kind of, Mr. Greenbaum is kind of getting his arms twisted here, that if he gives a little bit of land, then he'll get his 10 apartments. But the planning board in general is saying that they don't want it. So I don't know if this is the right way of going about doing this. It doesn't seem right to me.
Wait a minute. The planning board will not object to the ZBA, because that's where this has to go, because it's going to be non-conforming both lots. Mm-hmm. It's conforming right now, but the town, in fact, by splitting this, is going to make them both non-conforming.
So
that goes to the ZBA, and then it comes back to the planning board.
So Mr. Nixon?
So there's a process here. I was surprised that we had to go to the ZBA first in order to get the variance before we did an A&R with the planning board. So I raised that concern. I went to the chair, and Mr. Dwyer, and I asked him, okay, are we doing this in a different process? Because I would expect the A&R to happen, the approval not required, which divides the lot into two. And then we would go to the Zoning Board of Appeals in order to make sure that this is a viable provision. And he said, no, it's the other way around for Hadley. So we're following the proper process at this time.
Just for Hadley.
We make
our own. So Mr. Michkowski is talking before we've gone through a process at this point. We need to go to the ZBA first.
Well, let's assume that the ZBA grants the 10 units and splits the land. Mm-hmm. Or are they just discussing splitting the land? Okay.
Whatever's non-conforming, that's what we have to deal with.
Okay. So, subcommittee for the fire department comes out with their plan, and the town votes it down. Mm-hmm. That's going to happen. So, where does that leave Mr. Greenbaum? Is the planning board going to still allow them to continue, or because the substation doesn't happen, they'll deny it?
So we're talking hypotheticals right here.
That's what I hear, because I've always heard the planning board say they would not allow the multiple apartments like was being proposed. So I think for the owner, it would be nice to know up front, before he goes down this road,
this is not his first
this
rodeo.
Is going to be a problem. So.
This is not Mr. Greenbaum's first rodeo in any town doing different historical buildings. So I think he knows what he's up against. Right?
Yeah, I'm okay.
We've talked about this.
Okay, so thank you for your time here this evening.
Thank you.
You'll have more opportunity, it's clear. And
can I explain something to David? There's a third scenario.
Well,
which is very important to get out now.
I don't know, because if we're not here to talk about that tonight, and we have an appointment that we really need to be moving towards.
I don't know. It's going to be talked about.
But. Okay, well, I think it can be talked about at the subcommittee, and any information that Mr. Greenbaum needs as the party that we're actually negotiating with.
It actually benefits Mr. Greenbaum, what I'm saying.
Well, no. I just say we're not in negotiations right now, so I think.
And it's not part of the negotiations either. It's factual information that should be brought out, because you have to make a decision on this. Everyone does, and I think it's pertinent.
Well, we just agreed not to make a decision tonight.
No, it's not going to be tonight, but you
God
have to
six,
have the information
go ahead.
To dissolve it.
Please make it quick.
It's going to be very quick. Okay, the ZBA passes both. Mm-hmm. The planning board passes both. Mr. Greenbaum is in the clear to do his project. We go to town meeting. Mm-hmm. The substation doesn't fly.
Right.
Mr. Greenbaum still can go ahead with his project.
Mm-hmm.
That's all I want to say.
Okay. I mean, I think
so for clarification, David, his project can continue.
That's good.
All right. Again, thank you for your attendance, and anybody else is here to hear that. And we are moving along, and more to come. Okay.
Very nice.
Thanks.
And you need not talk to anybody but me.
Next item on the agenda was the owner's project manager agreement, and just a quick update or non-update, because we're going to pass over this. At the last meeting, we agreed to have myself, David Tudor, and as the chair of the MDC, and David Nixon negotiate with Colliers. Jennifer is in the process of scheduling that meeting. Again, we're running into vacations and the like, so we hope to have that meeting
next week.
Okay, not Friday, but likely Thursday?
Thursday.
Probably will be happening Thursday next week.
Okay.
So we'll be back at the next meeting with that information. Okay. Anything else on that? Nope. Okay.
We need a motion for David or anything to put him on the committee, or we're all set with that?
There is a resource person.
No, I'm talking about the chairman of the building committee.
We agreed to that at the last meeting.
Okay, that's fine then with me. I wasn't sure.
That's
very good.
Yeah, we voted him
in.
You guys
voted him in.
We
recommended. You got the building committee recommended.
Yeah. He even agreed.
And he accepted.
Yeah, he did. Finally.
Yeah, he did.
After he watched the show.
Probably the cast now.
Well, they're going
to see. I was simply confused because I went to the meeting yesterday, and that's when he accepted.
Got it.
So it just happened very quickly, and I wanted to make sure we had our bases covered.
Okay. Next item agenda, the town common. There's a desire tonight to discuss the parking situation on the West Street town common. I trust we're going to hear from the police department and the enforcement officer, David Nixon. We'd like to kick this off.
So this has been a source of concern for weeks and weeks and weeks. There's been a considerable amount of debate over whether this is a zoning issue that can be enforced by the zoning enforcement officer, or whether it's a streets and highways issue, which can only be dealt with by the select board. The West Street Common is owned by the town, both the road and the grass area. It is owned as a highway for highway purposes, and therefore it is a street for public conveyance. Anybody can drive on it, subject to weight restrictions. Anybody can park along it where it's not posted. The fire chief and the chief of police know that if they see an unsafe situation, they may issue tickets or take other appropriate traffic control measures. So we had that conversation, a four-way conversation between the fire chief and the police chief, myself, and the building inspector. Marla Warner took a look at the situation and suggested that maybe the most appropriate thing to do would be to post on the West Street Common south of Route 9, 30 feet back from the intersection, a sign saying no parking from here to the corner, in order to guarantee or to optimize the line of sight for anybody trying to access Route 9 from West Street and trying to turn into traffic, particularly given a active construction site just to the east there. We had a presentation by MassDOT this afternoon that charted out the accident areas for the town along Route 9, and over a multi-year period, that one of the hot spots, quote unquote hot spots, in Hadley and Route 9 was that intersection of West Street and Route 9. So that is Marla Warner's suggestion, is to place a sign there saying no parking from here to the intersection, and that be placed 30 feet back.
Okay. And my understanding is that the primary basis for the concern is that, because again, just thinking about, what's the real problem? And the real problem that I've heard articulated by a few people is there's a concern that due to the somewhat constant overflow parking for patrons of Esalen, that a number of people at any given time of day, probably early morning coffee and then maybe again at dinner time, the overflow is causing people to avail themselves of that section of the common adjacent to the building. And as a result of it, the primary concern, other than public safety, is that for maybe 4 or 5 feet in, that section of the common is now, the grass has been removed due to the parking, and they are concerned about damage to the common. So just throwing that out there. So I think part of what brought us here is the question of enforcement, and Tim, you and I also had a conversation. Do you want to share your position on your abilities?
So let's go back to day one with Echelon. Echelon certainly has been a very successful business. Certainly, this will be the fourth time this has been brought up in front of the select board with regard to parking. The site plan approval process actually got modified by the planning board because of this initial overflow parking, and they redefined the specifics relative to number of seating and whatnot with regard to parking. So in my belief, and I have talked to Bill Dwyer on this, that it's technically, because it's on-street parking, it's not really a site plan issue with the planning board. Have I ever gotten any specific true letter from the planning board stipulating that they had a hearing over this and stipulating that there is serious concern? No. I have gotten these short little one sentences that says there could be a possible violation. Please review. Again, as a zoning enforcement officer, I'm very defined in what my role is. When it comes to departments, they have hearing processes. If that hearing process so defines an issue relative to a violation, then they give me the information that there was a hearing, this is what was stated, this is what the proposed violation based on their department is. Mm-hmm. Then I, as a zoning enforcement officer, can, by our bylaws, fine them based on the non-criminal disposition ticketing process. And that starts at $100 and goes up to $300 per day. Mm-hmm. That's where my role is. I do not and will not be the person that makes a stipulation if something is a violation. Mm-hmm. My only role with regard to that is with signage. That is very specific in the bylaw that I make that defining decision.
And there's no signage today.
That we're not talking about signage. Mm-hmm. But other than that, mm-hmm. boards, commissions, and has those hearings, they have the ability, they make that decision and I enforce it.
Okay, thank you.
I know we spoke with the board three times since I've been on it. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I mentioned it and everybody laughed at it, but originally when the past police chief was here, we had talked about going 40 or 50 feet down each side, on the south side, the north side, and on the other end of the common. Don't leave the other ends out, because right. Now we're renting out the common, north side or south side or wherever. And we're going to have parking issues. We've had complaints on the north side, too.
You're talking about putting up the no parking here to corner?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So you've really got four intersections on the south side, and you've got 8 intersections on the north side. So if you were to put signage on the corners, and everybody laughed when I said this before, but put parking on the common side and gravel it, and that's it. Make parking places there. And somewhere down the line, meter it or charge for it. You're looking for a revenue. There you have it.
There goes the aesthetic value of the common.
One of the oldest commons
in the world.
And we're renting it and using it all the time now.
The only other aspect I have, Mr. Our highway superintendent, I commend him, but I think he left off a zero. Instead of 30, it should be 300 on each side. I stepped it off this morning. 30 feet ends up right in the middle of your entry into the Echelon, 30 feet. That's where it ends. And the problematic area is in front of the Weinzick house. They're constantly blocking their driveway. I've got numerous complaints from them. and you just go look at both sides for 300 feet. Actually, it should be 500 feet because it goes further than that, and they're tearing up both sides, parking on the common area of the municipality from where the sidewalk is to the road. That's all torn up. They put gravel in there to make additional parking. Actually, that all should be repaired and put back to its original state.
Okay, so is everybody clear on Mr. Neihardt's role at this point and what he can and cannot do? Is there a disagreement about what our zoning enforcement officer can do?
Thank you.
David, do you have any? You disagree with Tim?
No.
No,
no, I mean, okay. Yeah, I mean.
So then anybody on West Street can, I'm not being petty about it, but other people do have parking in their yard, and now there are people parking there every morning.
Picking corn and all sorts of good stuff.
Well, and Kim, we have to define who has jurisdiction
over
the issue.
It would be even a different thing if they were parked single file along there, but mm-hmm. now we're going into the common on a daily basis. You know, I mean, really, can we go over this way on their own property, over that way, and have them park on their own property? I mean, I don't get it myself, to tell you the truth, why they would allow that.
David?
What is the problem that we're trying to solve here?
Right. I mean, parking on the common.
Right.
Well, that is the display of what's happening.
No,
but what is the problem that we're trying to... If it's a public safety, if it... Allow me, please.
Sorry, yeah.
sorry to over-talk you, but if it's a public safety issue, the public safety officers are aware of what they're supposed to be able to do, and they can address it. They can certainly raise this on their own as an issue. They can take action. They can take enforcement. If it's an aesthetic issue, then we put grass seed down, or we add gravel, or we what. Put a park bench up or something like that. I mean, if it's an economic development issue, then we should be thinking about some sort of traffic management plan. So I think telling people not to do something without defining what you're trying to actually accomplish is something that is missing from the conversation here.
Okay, Mr. Michkowski, and then what I'm going to do is I'm going to...
Number one, I don't want my taxpayers...
Hang on, Dave, Jenny, let me just finish. Say,
what?
Just hold that thought for a second. So I'm just
really
setting the stage. We'll hear from Mr. Michkowski, but then what I'd like to do, again, in the spirit of time, because it's clear to me that this is not going to be resolved this evening, because we do need to frame this a little bit differently, was we'll continue this discussion. I'm not going to ignore it, but we'll continue it to a future point in time. Go ahead.
Number one, I don't want my taxpayers going to fix something that someone else ruined. We got the largest common in the Commonwealth, and you don't even live in this town. I like that common. And how would you like it if we told the planning board, every other business, go park on the roads? The building inspector don't care. The selectmen don't care. The police don't care. And we got this beautiful common, and you guys are sitting there and letting it be destroyed.
Well, based on
because a business outgrew its area. Mm-hmm.
But based on Mr. Neihardt's comments, it sounds like the planning board has some action that it
theoretically could. He never wrote back. When Jimmy Max wrote him, there's a possible violation. He never wrote back to, I never see no correspondence from him back to the planning board.
Okay.
There wasn't.
So
he showed me a letter that he typed out that he never sent.
Okay.
I got one more question.
I did speak with Mr. Maximoski on Sunday, and so he's aware that we're having the discussion tonight, and I did promise him a follow-up. Okay, go ahead, but then we really have to move on.
Chief, might as well get you in this conversation.
Why not?
When we had spoke with Dennis, the past chief, and we were talking about roughly 100 feet, I believe, back then, of posting the corners of all the commons, would you feel that's safe at that point for getting in and out of those intersections?
Yeah, I mean, my understanding of, I don't quote me on it, but I believe our bylaw as it relates to parking near intersections mirrors Mass General Law, which I believe is 20 feet, possibly 30 feet, I'm not sure. As far as public safety goes, an opening of a roadway, got to get emergency vehicles through,
yeah,
and line of sight to pull out. So 100 feet would be plenty.
Okay, so we'll hold that thought until next time.
Something else for us.
Oh, absolutely. You're waiting for somebody to get killed?
Are you suggesting 100 feet?
Yeah. 30 is way too short now. I agree with you with that. But 300, 500 is...
All right, we're going to continue this at another time.
I think we could wrap this up this evening with...
No, I don't.
If Mr. Neinhardt doesn't object to signage, you think signage should be there?
Don, we have a meeting with the Municipal Building Committee that we've got to get to. So what, final thought?
Just a quick comment. Another tool that Tim could use is check the occupancy of that building, because there's only two bathrooms, I think, in that place, and that's self-limiting, and then the square footage. So that needs to be looked at, and that would limit some of the cars that you see out there, perhaps.
Perhaps.
But as a thought.
Okay. So we've concluded the conversation about the town common. We'll continue it at a future point in time. We'll remember to put it on an agenda. We'll kind of try to lay this out and all of the things that we heard tonight, and maybe come to a conclusion next time. So Municipal Building Committee is on the agenda for this evening, and I believe you're here looking for some further direction from the Select Board. Did you want to?
You had the paper. You wrote the paper. I'm gonna let Tim see how you typed it up, the request, so.
I'm a little out of this. What?
We continued that conversation, so you don't need to do anything right now, other than hold the thought and we'll keep it coming. You're talking about the common?
No, I'm talking about municipal building.
Oh, okay.
All right. Did you want us to talk more about the different buildings, per se, or more about North Hadley Hall and what we perceive as some issues that need to be clarified directly right now?
Yeah, my understanding was that you wanted to get some feedback relative to the next actions that you wanted to. Kind of your thoughts on moving forward.
So certainly everybody's priority right now is with North Hadley Hall in regards to what to do with fire and park and rec.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we do have some scenarios. One is with rental,
mm-hmm.
possible rental. We need to start that process and mm-hmm. with making sure that we go in the right direction. If we have to put out an RFP for that, we did that back in January, but should we be doing that again? How should we go forward with that and try to get some discussion going with the possible landlord?
Mm-hmm. Okay. And so
we can do whatever you need from us, but
right. Or is that something that maybe David should
you
take up and get engaged in that and have some direct conversation?
Yeah, so the threshold for bidding for rental would be $35,000.
Per year.
The total value of the contract, whether it's a multi-year or a single year.
So if you went year to year, theoretically, so you could do a one-year $35,000 contract, or you could do a three-year $35,000 contract.
Could you do month to month?
Right.
I hope it's not that much.
I hope it's not that much, yeah.
Mm-hmm. So I can start working with you in order to come up with the procurement issues on that one.
That'd be good.
And also any contact with anybody who might be, I mean, we already know that there was one party interested in that sort of an arrangement, right? Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Seeing we're going to be talking with Mr. Greenbaum further, I think we should include this in that conversation if he would allow fire apparatus to stay there for a period of time if it doesn't affect his plans.
But before we do that, we want to make sure that, because I had a direct conversation with the fire chief, who said that's really not a viable option without some significant work to the existing building. And
right.
Then the question becomes, do we pay for it? Does Mr. Greenbaum pay for it? I don't see why he would.
No, I don't think he would either.
Yeah.
But the truck coming in is bigger than...
It's coming in October,
right,
too. He said,
right.
Yes.
It's bigger than what can go in that building.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yes.
So we need to look for another option. Go.
Mm-hmm. Okay,
do
so,
it.
So that's one. So
should have been done.
Okay.
I don't think, what I'm trying to say is I don't want that eliminated. I think Mr. Nixon could include that if he feels it's not a viable option, then eliminate it. But if it's a possibility with a minimal cost to anyone involved.
Okay, so you'll keep that open with Joel?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
And then
yep.
It's on that same front with Park and Rec, that is a discussion that needs to be taken with mm-hmm. Mr. Greenbaum also. He has
he's looking at defining his schedule with regard to the possible date of purchase and his design phase and everything else. So there could be a little bit of lax, and there will be some lax time here for the Park and Rec after the October 1st.
You're talking about the Park and Rec programming or the Park and Rec office?
The office. So we got to look at that.
Could we look at alternatives for the office? I mean, I don't see why we can't start that process now. We still own these town buildings, so could we look at the Hooker School Town Hall?
Yeah, I think we have room for the space needs for the Park and Rec office. Mm-hmm. The programming.
That's a separate conversation. That's separate.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think we need to start that process, and mm-hmm. so we can, if there's anything that we can do to help out, we'll be there.
Okay. Mm-hmm. So we'll put that on.
I have a lovely room for them.
Okay. Good. Yeah. All right. Okay. So next.
We have enough. We have enough time to look at these because we've already finished the job with the fire station right now. So to look for places to rent for the fire department, rent for Park and Rec.
Yeah, we said go. We said do it.
Yeah.
And we're looking.
Okay, we just have 2 minutes left before we have a schedule.
The other thing I think our thought process is to go forward with. I'm sorry.
You can talk.
Our thought process to start on getting together some maintenance items for next fall to get together with you, get that list going, get some estimates together. And work out everything that we're going to go forward with that we believe that should be done for the next go around for fall and spring.
Everybody comfortable with that?
Yes.
Yeah.
Definitely. Yeah.
Yep. Absolutely. Okay. And then North. Can I just ask a question about North Hadley substation? So I know that Willie's now on that committee officially after the consent agenda tonight. My understanding is that the Municipal Building Committee has not yet taken a position on it, but that you're looking probably for a more, again, your committee moves forward with the process, a more formal presentation to the Municipal Building Committee on exactly what that's going to look like. Because I know, at least from the folks I've talked to, there's a clear, there's a split within the committee, but still some speculation about how this is going to wind up.
Well, I think the 26th is going to be the date that we're going to be able to figure things out. Okay. If we get something, then we can look at that. If not, I mean, it's certainly going to be at the North Hadley site. I mean, that's pretty well defined quite quickly after we open that up. The other thing that we need to talk about tonight very quickly is the public safety roof. Mm-hmm. Those specs have been redone, revised. We voted on them last night, and if I'd just like to work with David on trying to get that back out on the street. Mm-hmm. So,
the green light to go out to bid?
Yes.
Yeah,
make
absolutely.
A motion to go out to bid for the roof again.
Right. I second the motion.
Okay. All in favor of that?
Aye. Aye.
Thank you.
Okay. All right.
Was there a minimum period of time we need for that?
Has to go through the procurement process again, so we need to put together the specifications. We got to do the advertising and give people a reasonable amount of time to come back. So probably take about a month for all that to unfold.
So I'll give you the specs tomorrow morning.
That'll be great. Thank you.
Okay. So is that good for now for you guys?
That's it for now. So.
Yeah, John.
North Hadley substation. The chief already did a floor plan.
Mm-hmm.
We're going to be pretty well in line to use some help for an estimate of what it's going to cost to put this together.
Right, okay.
So we're meeting tomorrow night on that.
Okay. All right, good. Okay, so we all set with you guys? Okay, all right. Okay, David, do we need to deal with the budget transfers tonight or no?
No, it's all handled by the Finance Committee.
Okay, the other item we had was forestry management. Donald, I know this was your article. Do you want us to put it on the next ones rather than give it short shrift? Or?
I can just give a short thing and get rid of it. I think it's a good idea to investigate this again. That's how our stabilization was started with the first cutoff, and we got 45K for it, and that's how we started our stabilization. We haven't addressed it in many a year, and so I would just like to see a forester go in there, work with our town administrator, and see if it's a viable time to do it again so we could achieve some revenue for the town.
So maybe we can get assistance for free through the state or something, maybe?
So I'm working management with the Conservation Commission on this issue. I think I've got a forester who will give you a once over for free.
Okay.
We'll come back. We're also looking at how this fits into the open space plan that's being revised. So we'll have some recommendations for you in the future on this.
Okay, Chris. All right, thank you.
Wait for me, I'll be out soon, John.
Yeah, so. Right. Oh, okay. So, quick announcements before we.
Two quick ones. I'd like to say thanks to 20 Acres Farms. As you can tell, the flowers out on the front of the town hall are still very much alive and look gorgeous. And
even with the dust.
Even with the dust and the heat. And I see Joan Zusko out there frequently watering them every day. So a big thank you to Joan and 20 Acre Farm. And then we have condolences to the family of Pete Lorenzo. He passed away last Saturday. It's really kind of ironic. Pete started out living next door to me on Bay Road. And he and Mary Lou weren't married, and he and Ed Mann lived upstairs, and another couple lived downstairs. Needless to say, we had some pretty good times, and known him all these years, and so it's he was a great person, and his family and community will miss him. He was a softball league coach, and you know, he just contributed to Booster Club and followed his girls' sports and everything else. And so I'm sure condolences to Mary Lou and the girls.
And I believe services are tomorrow
and Friday. Yes.
Anything else before we adjourn?
Yeah.
Chief?
I just want to say a quick thank you as well. After the events in Dallas last Friday, our community has rallied around police officers, and we have received all kinds of goodies, cards, thank you notes. Donald and his wife wrote us a nice note that we have in the squad room. So I just wanted to say a quick thank you to all the folks out there who are thanking us. It's very, very touching.
So we thank you.
Yeah. I think sometimes we don't say thank you.
Yeah,
exactly. Unfortunately, that's what it takes. Okay, so we're going to be moving into executive session. So
I will make a motion to go into executive session as per the provisions of MGL Chapter 30A, Section 21A, to discuss the discipline or dismissal of a or complaints or charges brought against the public officer, employee, staff member, or individual, and this is in regards to police department, not to reconvene in open session.
Okay. Is there a second?
I'll second the motion.
I'm not here.
As chair of the Hadley Select Board, I state that the board has moved and seconded to enter into executive session, and I state that discussing the matter in open session will have an adverse effect on the town of Hadley.
Roll call vote, Luskevitz?
Yes.
Keegan?
Yes.
Chunglo?
Yes.
Paczynski?
Yes.
All right, thank you, everybody. Good night.